you so much for starting your weekend right here. Of course, it's Hockey Night Online. David Amber and Mike Brophy, of course, CBCSports.ca senior writer. It's busy time of year.
It sure is.
Yeah, we're just a few weeks away from the big moment, the Big 16 into the postseason. Lots to be determined. This is an interactive show, though. We ask you guys to log on, interact with us at Hockey Night, at David Amber, at Hockey Brof, hashtag Hockey Night as well. Facebook, I'm not on Facebook, but I hear it's a good thing. Hockey Night in Canada. All sorts of stuff to talk about. There was 10 games last night. The playoff picture becoming a little bit more crystallized. Teams like the Colorado Avalanche punching their ticket to the postseason. Let's start, though, with a rematch of last year's Stanley Cup final. The Bruins doing a number on the Hawks, a 3-0 win. Are the Bruins now officially your Stanley Cup favorite?
Well, they're not my Stanley Cup favorite. Yes, they are a Stanley Cup favorite. I'll tell you, I picked up the Toronto Sun this week, and I looked at Mike Zeisberger. My buddy Mike Zeisberger did his weekly power rankings, and he had Boston number one overall in the NHL. And I'm thinking, okay, wait a minute. How can a team from the Eastern Conference, the weaker conference, be the number one team in the NHL? And you know what? The more I thought about it, the more on some level it makes sense. This Boston Bruins team is so strong in every area of the game. And as you watch them, David, I think they play like a Western Conference team. They're very physical. They've got strength throughout the lineup. They've got good goaltending. I think they match up against all the best Western Conference teams. And you know what else? Claude Julien, I don't know. This guy doesn't seem to get the just dues. I think he's one of the best coaches in the NHL. He gets his players to buy in, to play a very disciplined defensive style, and they've got scoring. Like, you know, their leading scorer only has 60 points. What do they have? Seven players with 40 or more points. So, hey, you want to play a tough game? They'll play a tough game. You want to play a skating game? They'll play a skating game. Are they my Stanley Cup favorite? No, they're not.
They're not.
But they're right in there.
All right. Are you getting the heavy metal music in your ear as well? I'm getting vibes here. I feel like going to a concert or something tonight. Boston has won 13 of their last 14 games, so they're also peaking at the right time. They did do a number on the Hawks, a little redemption from last year's Stanley Cup final loss. The funny thing is, we might just see one Canadian team in the postseason for the first time since 1973. That team pretty much locked in as the Montreal Canadiens, and they're locked in right now, winning seven of their last eight games. Does this remind you at all of the 1993 Habs, the last Canadian team to win the Stanley Cup? Great goaltending. They had Patrick Waugh in 93. They have Carey Price.
Yeah.
Balanced scoring and peaking right now. Does this, anything remind you of them?
That's a bit of a challenge for me. You know, I like the Montreal Canadiens. I don't love them. Hey, I acknowledge that they're a team that's building in the right direction. I think they've done a really nice job becoming a little bit bigger. I still think they're a little too small up front. But overall, the Canadiens are a team that, because the East is so wide open, and with the exception of the Boston Bruins, I think every team is infinitely beatable. Mm-hmm. The Montreal Canadiens are one of those teams, if they're hitting on all cylinders and Carey Price is playing his game to the best of his ability, they could make some noise in that they could at least make the Eastern Conference final. Now, the New York Rangers seem to be a team peaking at the right moment, too, and as much as the, you know, Toronto Maple Leafs have lost six in a row, I haven't quite thrown them under the bus yet. I think if they can get a win tonight and a win on Saturday, they get back to believing in themselves.
All
but you got to be impressed with the Habs.
Don't get ahead of ourselves. We're getting to the Leafs in just a matter of moments. We got to talk a little bit about the Habs. And that was that impressive 5-4 win last night against Detroit. Leaf Nation very excited about the Habs doing
enough
to help
the
their playoff chances. It was a crazy game. 2-1 Montreal after two periods, and then six goals scored in that decisive third period. 5-4 win over the Habs. And speaking of Montreal, and you talked about how they're playing well, they have balanced scoring. A big part of that's Thomas Vanek. They are 7-1 since acquiring Vanek. Daniel Briere, his former teammate in Buffalo, already said, "I'm doing the hard sell to keep Vanek here after this season." Do you see this now, if they keep winning, and let's say they win a playoff round or two, do you see Vanek saying, "This is an environment I want to be in," even though all signs point for him going to Minnesota?
Yeah, I mean, it very well could, depending on how they do in the playoffs. But the fact that Thomas Vanek turned out a great contract offer from the New York Islanders really indicates to me that he's hell-bent on getting to unrestricted free agency, which is fine. I think Vanek's a very good player. I don't think he's a great player, but I think he's put himself in a position where, by becoming a UFA, he's going to cash in big time, whether it's with Minnesota, Montreal, or another hockey team. You know, he's not even in the top 20 in scoring in the NHL. Maybe some of that has to do with the fact that he spent most of the year
Buffalo
with the New York Islanders and with Buffalo. But, you know, I always worry about the tax issue. in Quebec. A lot of players say they don't want to play there. Unless the Montreal Canadiens offer him a couple million more, then look for him to look at Minnesota.
All right, we'll keep that under our watch as well. Meanwhile, there was 10 games last night, maybe the most thrilling finish. A 13-round shootout between the Lightning and the Islanders. The Lightning set up to face, of course, the Montreal Canadiens in that first round. Steve Stamkos, a great spinorama. People loved it last night, but you know, 20% of games end of the shootout. You want to get rid of this thing?
I'm a fan of the shootout, so I don't want to get rid of it. I am in favor of perhaps extending overtime for maybe two more minutes or even going down to 3-on-3. But if you're going to say that the shootout's a gimmick, then going down to 3-on-3 is every bit as much of a gimmick in my mind. You know, that shootout last night was exciting. If there was no shootout, David, everybody goes home, and when their friends say who won the game, they say, nobody. What do you mean, nobody? I don't like tie hockey games.
Nor do
I hated going to games that ended in ties, so give me the shootout where players show their great, great skill.
I guess what they have to do is find a way to encourage teams to not trying to just go, hey, let's get to the shootout.
Yes.
That's the thing, maybe 4-on-4 to 3-on-3, which is something Kenny Holland has suggested, or a 10-minute overtime. We'll have to figure it out, but the league is looking into that. Again, we ask you guys to get interactive, get your questions to us here at Hockey Night Online. This one coming courtesy of the C-Notes at Coach's Corner versus TNT Craig Sager in a contest of suits. Who comes out on top? Okay, it is March Madness time. Let's take a look. Wow. Your thoughts here. Who wins this battle of Blazers?
Well, nobody beats Don Cherry. Are you kidding me? I remember when I worked at the Hockey News, we did a pictorial in our summer magazine on all Don's wildest suits. So, hey, they're both good contenders, but nobody beats the Donald.
Those are pretty good suits. Craig Sager has actually burned some of his suits recently in a little publicity stunt. So the fun March Madness getting down to the Sweet 16. Of course, the NHL is going to be weaning it down to the 16 teams to make the postseason. Another question coming our way. The Western Conference standings, and let's lead into the question based on the standings we see in the West. And you see St. Louis comfortably in first overall in the West. A great battle in the Pacific Division. Anaheim, San Jose, both of them want to avoid LA, understandably, in the first round. But when you look down, you see Vancouver there, not dead, but clearly on life support here. Last night, it was a tough one. They got 1 point they needed to.
Yeah, they certainly did. You know, I said a week ago that I thought in the Western Conference that eight teams that were in the playoff positions are going to be the eight teams that go to the playoffs.
Yeah.
It's still interesting. Every game at this stage of the year is like a playoff game. Vancouver Canucks have made a nice turnaround, but in my view, it's probably too little too late. I will say, moving forward, it's nice for them to at least see Zach Cassian playing some good hockey, because, you know, as they look forward to next season, this is a guy, a young player, that they're going to start to depend on, and he looks like now he's figured out how to be a productive guy in the NHL.
Bigger disappointment, Vancouver this year or Ottawa this year?
Oh, I'd say Vancouver, because I think Vancouver coming into the year was looked upon as a potential Stanley Cup threat.
Yeah.
I've said all along the window of opportunity was closing, but I didn't think it was shut, and it looks like it's shut.
Absolutely. God, everything has gone wrong in Vancouver this year. We'll see what they do in the offseason. Meanwhile, the Eastern Conference standings, a very tight race. Four teams locked down fighting for two spots. Toronto, Washington, Detroit, Columbus, all with 80 points. Of course, Columbus, Detroit, and Washington with games in hand on the Leafs, who've lost six straight. This is a huge weekend for Toronto. A game in Philly tonight, a game at home against Detroit tomorrow. Is this it? How many points do they need in those two games to conceivably have a shot to go to the postseason?
They need 4 points. There's no question in my mind. If they could figure out a way to get 5 points, that would help. You know, but I don't think they can afford to give up a point simply because they've played more games than the teams that they're either chasing or that are in the race with them. So they've got to win two straight games.
Yeah, and a lot of people are saying they have eight games left. They've got to go at least, at the bare minimum, 5-2-1. So if they lose, let's say they lose one or two of the games this weekend, they're putting themselves in a situation where they're going to have to run the table.
Run the table, yeah. And that's not going to happen.
Yeah, especially if you go in then at that point on an eight-game losing streak. Does take us to our next question. Tyler Chindamo, he wants to know, if the Leafs fail to make the playoffs, there has to be a huge movement in the organization. These last six games were embarrassing. What do you expect to happen? Let's say, worst case scenario, the Leafs don't make the postseason. What's going to happen, bro?
Well, I mean, the obvious thing is there might be a coaching change. Randy Carlyle was not brought on board by Dave Nonis. That was a Brian Burke hire. So, and I'm not saying fire the coach. I would never say that. That's not my job. But I'm saying it's an obvious potential move. Here's the way I view the Maple Leafs. They've got one of the best number one lines in the National Hockey League. They've got two young stud defensemen in Riley.
Riley
and Gardner. And they've got a very good number one goaltender in Bernier. Do you have to shake the entire tree and have it go down? You know, I just don't see that happening. So I think they've got to get a better support cast. I really think they missed Clark MacArthur and Leo Komarov this year, two support guys who played very well for them. They let those guys go. I think they've paid a price for that.
They're a different team this year, too. You used to hear I talk to players, and they'd say, yeah, the Leafs are tough to play against. It was guys like Komarov who, had to have your head on a swivel. You didn't know when. That guy just loved to hit. I think he led the league in hits last year. How different a team are they to play this year, bro?
Oh, they're a much easier team to play against for a couple of reasons. One, they don't fight as often. They seem to have gone a different direction. And they self-implode. I mean, look at the mistakes that lead to goals that the Toronto Maple Leafs make. They can't break the puck out of their own zone. When the opposition gets the puck in the Toronto defensive zone, they freewheel. Toronto just doesn't seem to play that physical game. I know Cody Franson is up among the leaders in hits, but can you remember one big hit from Cody Franson? He rubs guys out. He takes them out. He does his job, but he's not a punishing hitter. They don't punish the opposition in the defensive zone.
You mentioned really quickly one thing that you would like to, one thing you said really quickly you'd like to see tonight from the captain, Dion Phaneuf. What was that?
I think Dion Phaneuf has to go out on his first shift, go right at Scott Hartnell and challenge him to a physical confrontation. You know Hartnell at some point in the game is going to challenge him, so why not be proactive after probably your worst game of the year? Come out, show your teammates you mean business.
All right, it's going to be big business for the Leafs this weekend. Of course, we've got the game Saturday night, the Leafs and the Red Wings on Hockey Night in Canada. What's the big game you're looking forward to this weekend?
Well, the game tonight. I think the game in Philadelphia presents such an amazing challenge for Toronto on a six-game losing streak against a team that's playing quite well and playing physical. The Leafs either wake up tonight or they go to sleep into a coma.
All right, well, the Rangers and Flyers look destined to meet in the first round. The Canadiens and the Lightning, that looks to be a lock as well. Not that much, though, very crystal clear at this point as far as the other teams fighting for playoff spots. Keep your eyes on cbcsports.ca. Join us here on Monday, Hockey Night Online. Of course, you can reach out to us on Twitter at Hockey Night, at David Amber, at Hockey Brophy, hashtag Hockey Night. Also, join us on Facebook for all your thoughts and ideas. Thanks for tuning in. We will catch you next time. For Mike Brophy, I'm David Amber. See you next time, Hockey Night Online. Oh!